listening to the DFS On Deck podcast, brought to you by Linestar, the top-rated DFS tool set and number one companion for DraftKings, FanDuel, and Yahoo Daily Fantasy. Go Linestar Premium now at linestarapp.com. Now, here are your hosts, fantasy baseball experts Joe Pisapia and Chris Meaney.
Hey, yo, what's up, everybody? It's me, Joey P, Joe Pisapia, and welcome to On Deck right here on the Linestar app. It's me, it's Chris Meaney, it's Tuesday, and we're back to work. I know most people had off yesterday. Chris Meaney did not because, well, he's Canadian, and that's the, you know, that's the cross he must bear. But for the rest of us Americans here in the lower section of North America, we are here and back to work, and we were here working yesterday too, by the way, in case you missed it. We were still here and just talking DFS, having some fun, a few laughs. And Chris Meaney, I'm ready to get back at it today, baby.
Oh yes, me too. It's a weird slate. Like, there's not a lot of pitching studs on the board. Like, I'm actually having a hard time finding some that I like, so I might have to spend up for some bats today.
Well, I can tell you the overall feel today when you look at this slate plays much more to tournaments than to cash.
Oh, yes.
Because it seems very wide open in that sense. So that's something that I would put out there and keep in mind. I don't necessarily I always prefer to do more heavily on the cash side when it comes to Major League Baseball. We talk about that on the program, and that's the advice we like to give most people too, unless you have, you know, a huge budget and you're working with, and in which case you can feel free to be more of a GPP player. But normally when you're talking about baseball, the cash game scenario is really where you can continue to just double up your money. But I think when you don't have a slate where you really like a couple big-time pitchers in good spots, that it really does kind of open you up to a little bit more. If you're more of a 70-30 cash game player at a 75%, maybe it's a little bit more 50-50 or even 60-40 for GPP tonight. How would you approach it, Chris?
Yeah, I think you nailed it. Yeah, when there's, for me, that is my first initial thought as I'm looking at this pitching slate and, you know, looking at DraftKings right now, I see Strasburg atop the board. Oh, he's got to go into Atlanta and face the Braves, and he's gotten roughed up over his past two outings against Atlanta, dating back to last year, he's yet to face him. And then you see Frankie Montas. Yeah, he's been really good, but he's up at 11-3, more expensive than Rich Hill, Matt Boyd, David Price, like some of these guys who are, you know, bigger names, and we've seen a higher ceiling from those guys anyways. So I think, yeah, you approach it as, you know, a tournament slate. You take some shots on some lower price guys, some guys with some upside, and that's how you attack it. Or if you want, you can spend up on some cash bats and or some expensive bats and still roll them out in cash. And because everybody is going to be in the same situation in terms of pitching. So I typically, when I see a slate like this, Joe, I want to play tournaments, and I'm not afraid to get a little nuts.
No, I love it when you get nuts. Yeah. I mean, you're such a mild-mannered fellow my whole life that I've known you. Are you just like, you know, what's your idea of getting nuts? What's Chris Meaney's idea of getting nuts? Like, you drink the milk like a day past expiration? Like, that's your crazy?
No.
No, that's too crazy for you.
That's too crazy for me. Yeah, I won't go that far. I don't know. I'm a big sports fan, so I get fired up about, you know, the littlest things. So,
all right, very good. Well, let's take a look back at yesterday, because we always like to look back before we look forward. Yesterday, boy, I think the Nats hit a new low yesterday. Jose Urena, I know he's had like a 2 ERA in his last like half a dozen starts and all, but it's still Jose Urena. They should have hit him. They didn't. It's terrible. I mean, Max Scherzer goes out there, throws a, you know, quality start, and they got nothing. Now, Urena did last longer than him. I give him a ton of credit, but, man, that one hurt. That one definitely hurt. That should have been a lock, and shame on you, Washington Nationals. Shame.
Yeah, absolutely. This team is – we've been talking about them for a while. Like, they struggle with their bats. We gave them excuses when Turner and Rendon were out of the lineup. There's no excuse for them to be losing this many ball games in a row, and Scherzer reminds me a lot like DeGrom last year. He's not getting the run support. I mean, he's allowing a couple runs every single outing, and he's just not getting any support. Urena is just – you're right. He has been on a bit of a run. This is the second time he's faced Washington, and he's allowed two or fewer runs. So the Nationals cannot even hit one of the highest contact pitchers in baseball. So it's not good right now for them. And that's why I have issues rolling out Strasburg against Atlanta. Like, even if he pitches a gem, like, are they going to be able to give him some run support? So it's tough sledding for Washington right now. It's brutal.
It is a big game for Gerrit Cole yesterday, 12 strikeouts over the six innings, huge game against Hamels. We talked a little bit about Hamels yesterday. That also kind of didn't work out there. That big, you know, five runs in the third inning, that kind of blew him up. But it's funny, you're looking at Hamels and Gerrit Cole. They have identical ERAs on the season. 4.02. It's just an amazing thing. And yet Gerrit Cole is 5-5 and Cole Hamels is 4-1. So go figure. Go figure wins and losses, people. I mean, that's just one of those fun baseball anomalies there. We did like some offense over there in the Red Sox-Indians game, and we sure got it. We got 17 runs in that one. So that was one of the good things yesterday. I'm pissed because even though we were all over the A's yesterday, and God, did we talk them up. We did.
We were just
bathing ourselves in Oakland Athletics yesterday, Chris and myself. And even up until the moment where it came out of my mouth, when I called my shot, it was between Matt Chapman and Matt Olson. Yeah. Even to the point where I said, Matt, I didn't know which one was going, which last name was going to come out. And I was so mad at myself because I had this weird gut feeling about Chapman. I went, no, go save. I'll go Matt Olson. And I said, Olson. And it was the wrong Matt. But Matt Chapman went yard. But we talked about him in the stack and having that grouping there with Simeon and Chapman and Olson and having you talked about Profar. So all around, great stuff there by the A's, exactly what we wanted. So we got that right. You got Yasiel Puig right yesterday. Now, who was your home run call? You went tougher yesterday.
I went Joey Votto. I went completely off the board. Now, he didn't get the home run, but he had another solid day at the plate, and I really just wanted to hammer home the Reds. Now, they let us down, you know, a little bit in that first game. They did get some offense. I mean, Senzel was 2-for-4, had an RBI. Joey Votto was 3-for-5, scored a couple runs, cashed in with an RBI. Suarez, 3-for-4, 2 RBI. But they really did overall. They had the – the outing that they had in game two is what we were looking for in game one. But nonetheless, this offense has really kind of turned it around. You mentioned Puig with a home run, Dietrich, another one. There's some beef between Cincinnati and Pittsburgh. He watched his home run again. If you remember earlier in the year, he did the exact same thing and then he got plunked. So it's interesting. I'll be interested to see what happens over the next couple games in this series. But nonetheless, the same thing applied, and it will apply again today. These Reds bats are cheap and they're starting to turn a corner. They're starting to score some runs.
Yeah, we faded DeGrom too, which was the smart thing to do. So we got that right. Sonny Gray got the W, another guy that we highlighted yesterday. So overall, a lot more good than bad. That's for damn sure. Lance Lynn, a little disappointing there. He didn't pitch poorly so much as the Rangers really didn't show up against Tommy Malone. I know you pointed out they can't hit lefties, but boy, oh boy, they really drove it home. I was giving him a little credit against Tommy Malone, but
that's twice now. Yeah, twice in a row they faced Tommy Malone and they just haven't been able to do anything. Lynn was solid. I mean, he had 10 strikeouts in six innings.
Look, all right, so maybe I won't be so tough on it. Lance Lynn was good yesterday for what we wanted, especially if you broke up the slate like we talked about. If you had Lance Lynn just in the late slate together there with Kershaw, then you did all right. So if you broke it up, then you were okay. Things were in the right direction. But that was yesterday. Today's the new day. Yes, it is. So let's get after it. We've got a 6:30 start here in New York because that's what time this game always starts in New York nowadays. Masahiro Tanaka is 9.6 against Eric Lauer. Now, this is a time where, look, we have some of these right-handed bats like Gary Sanchez, Luke Voit. Again, they continue to be super expensive on the DraftKings side. On the FanDuel side of things, Tanaka's price, guess what? Let's see. What is it? It was 9.6. Oh, wait. What do you think it is, Chris?
They're hungover.
It's 9.6. Oh, dude, Memorial Day was yesterday.
Memorial Day, yeah.
Dude, I was out at the barbecue getting hammered, man. Just what does DK have? Oh, 9.6. Okay, same thing. Luke Voit a little cheaper, though. So is Aaron Hicks and Sanchez, 4.1, 4.2, 3.6. This is a night where Gary Sanchez is red hot. As long as he's in the lineup tonight, I think that this is one of those times where on FanDuel, which I don't love to do, but to play the catcher instead of the first baseman, I think you could do that with Sanchez tonight.
Oh, he's just so hot. You can't ignore him. Yeah, he's on a heck of a run. We talked about trends before and just, you know, following them and getting on board. And Gleyber Torres, and I know Aaron Hicks has been, you know, very slow starting, let's say that. But for Gleyber Torres, a 3.7 price tag on FanDuel, that's another one. He's one of the better values on the board. So if you're playing over on FanDuel, you get this price, you plug in Gary Sanchez. If you get in on the main slate over on FanDuel, you'll be able to play these 6:30, 6:40 games. So yeah, you can't ignore him at this point, Joe. He's just feeling it.
No, and I'll tell you what, Josh Naylor on the other side of this game, guess how much on FanDuel? 2.5. Yay! Yeah, hooray for cost-effective rookies. I love it. Can't get enough of it. It's the theme of the year. So Josh Naylor, and look, I know it's Tanaka, and Tanaka's a good pitcher, but it's still a lefty bat.
He gets up home runs.
Right, so I'm saying, the guy's got power. 2.5, lefty bat. I think he's the kind of guy you throw in there tonight as a utility guy on FanDuel, and you make it work. I think that's a lineup saver. That's a good one. All right, on the FanDuel side here, Jordan Lyles in this next game, 8.6 as Pittsburgh continues to face the Cincinnati Reds. Lucas Sims will be taking the ball for them, it looks like. Sims is 7.6 on DK. So, look, again, you have Jordan Lyles here. I think rolling with Votto continuously is still good. You're still getting a discount on DraftKings on him, 3.4 for Votto. I still think that's terrific. The rest of this lineup, Yasiel Puig, 3.8. That's another one. Still cost-effective there. You got to pay more for Suarez. That's fine. But if you want the stack, I'm not against it. On the Pittsburgh side here, Josh Bell, 4.3. And on the DraftKings side of things here, Josh Bell, 5.7. So completely out of whack here. Can't build on DraftKings. But on FanDuel, I think you put Josh Bell in play. I think there's going to be some runs in this one today.
Yeah, for sure. If yesterday was any indication, there's going to be a lot of runs scored. I mean, both teams have a team implied total of 4.9 for Pittsburgh, basically 5 and 5.2 for Cincinnati. So, I mean, Josh Bell has just been, he's been lights out. He's been unbelievable. And Sims doesn't have a big track record in the majors, but, you know, large enough, 73 innings on his resume. He's walking 4 per, only striking out 7, and he checks in with and only a 37% ground ball rate. So there could be an opportunity for some home runs in this. So that's a 40% fly ball rate for his career. Votto, listen, he's got 4 straight games with multi-hits. So he's starting to heat up a bit. You just take advantage of that discount on DK. And, of course, on FanDuel, like basically free. Anytime somebody checks in at under 3 and Puig is 3 over there too, you got to get on board. And if Dietrich's going to hit in that 4 spot, if that's going to be a thing, it was a thing yesterday for...
Look, he's been good this year. You know, yeah. that was a guy that floated out there a long time in free agency this year. And I didn't get it. He's got position versatility. I don't know why more teams didn't seek him out. I thought it was a weird signing when the Reds of all teams signed him because they had such a deep team and they had Senzel coming through the system. It just didn't make much sense. And then, sure enough, they signed him. Sure enough, he's been playing, and he's been terrific.
He's got 14 bombs already. He's got a 53% fly ball rate this year, which is one of the highest in baseball. And you're playing in that park?
It's bananas. I don't. Derek Dietrich is probably one of the least talked about guys this year, or the most productive, and probably he was like a free player in your season long. It's just nuts.
Oh, absolutely.
All right, on a night where there's not a lot of pitchers to love, this one I love. Matt Boyd, 10.3 on DK. FanDuel went, okay, let's be a little different. 10.2, okay, whatever, dude. I love that FanDuel's like the stoner version in this scenario. I don't know why, but it's just...
Well, because like we're just looking at these values. We're seeing guys that are
on... For all I know, it could be the opposite. For all I know, FanDuel comes out every night, you know, quicker. And I don't know.
Yeah, maybe.
It's just funnier to make FanDuel kind of the stoner end of this because it's a character and it's fun.
Yeah.
Look, I know Matthew Boyd a couple starts ago had a bump in the road there. I'm all in on him. I know it's a tougher ballpark. I don't care. I think Matt Boyd goes out there, handles his business, and on a night where the pitching is rough, I am all in on Matt Boyd tonight. I think Ronnie Rodriguez, Nick Castellano, some of these guys who've been hitting can do enough there against Dylan Bundy to get the job done. So I'm all in on Matt Boyd. Are you with me? Are you getting on the boat with me? Let's go, Chris.
Yeah, for sure. We just talked about some of the pitching, you know, on this slate and some of the top tier ones and some tougher spots, and Boyd isn't in one. So overall, the Orioles striking out 23% of the time. That's the 16th highest mark in baseball, but against lefties, it's 27% of the time, and it's a top 8 mark in baseball. So it's even better for Boyd in this spot. You know what? I would actually get behind Bundy against Detroit if it wasn't for Boyd. Like, he's just going up against Boyd, and that's not a good matchup. Like, Bundy can actually rack up a couple strikeouts and maybe get, you know, through 4 or 5 innings without giving up home runs, because that's, you know, what he does against a team like Detroit. But it's just to go up against Boyd, it's not a good spot for him. So I think you can roll out Boyd in cash if you are a cash player and you're looking for a pitcher. I think that's the one pitcher that you can feel, you know, safe with.
I feel pretty good about it. Now, you got Nick Pivetta coming back up to start, too. So he is 6 points. He's super cheap. On the DraftKings side, which is not actually on FanDuel side, he's 6.5. Now, look, the strikeout potential is there. He's 8.9 on DK, so a totally different story there. He's facing Adam Wainwright in this one. Now, Pivetta, if you go back, obviously the strikeout potential is there. Since he got sent down there, he's got 50 strikeouts in AAA, which is terrific and all. He's got a 3.41 ERA, but he's still walking guys. So over 37 innings, he struck out 50 guys since he got sent down. That's terrific. You like the strikeout potential, but do you like that strikeout potential tonight, even though it's at home against the Cardinals?
No, I don't. I agree.
I don't like it either.
Yeah, I can't get behind it, and you nailed it. You said it with the walks. I mean, yeah, the strikeouts are nice, but he's walked 20 guys over that span, and that's all he did in the majors before he was sent down. I mean, he had 18 innings, and, you know, he walked a ton of guys. He gave up 31 hits in those 18 innings and 17 runs. So normally I would take a shot on him in a tournament, but I can't do it against the Cardinals. I just have too much respect for this team in St. Louis. They don't strike out a lot. They take their walks. They have a ton of fly ball hitters in their lineup, and Pivetta has struggled with home runs. That's been his downside. So, you know, I would attack him.
I would too. Goldschmidt. I like Goldschmidt, 3-7 on FanDuel, DeJong, 3-6. Matt Carpenter, 3-6, got dropped in the order too.
So yes.
Keep an eye on that. Jose Martinez is just 2.8. Marcelo Zuna is 4. If Dexter Fowler's at the top of that order again at 3, that's an intriguing one.
Definitely.
On DraftKings, Goldschmidt's 4.1. So, like, there's no discount on DK as per usual in terms of the hitters, like the quotient, even the quotient's just a little bit further on the FanDuel side. So there's not a whole lot of value. You have to get what you have to pay for it, basically, on DraftKings tonight if you want St. Louis. On FanDuel, it's not that bad. Like, I think that's a big time stack in FanDuel tonight. It will be popularly owned. I'm sure the ownership will be high on it, but I don't care. And not that I love Adam Wainwright either, but I don't know, man. That Phillies offense just continues to, every time you think they're turning it around, they put up another stinker there. So I don't know. And speaking of stinkers, Toronto put up a stinker too yesterday. They should have been better. They were not. But look, in terms of what against the Rays, they're in a less hitter friendly environment. I'm kind of passing on this game. Although you got Clayton Richard out there, is there anything you really love? I know Willy Adames has been moved up in the lineup too, so that's an intriguing one to keep an eye on too, because he's been typically very, very cheap on the year. He's just 2.6 on FanDuel tonight, and Choi is just 2.7. So the middle of that order against the lefty, Richard, you know, love Choi against the lefty, but I'm just saying, like, that is one thing to keep in mind, because Clayton Richard, I don't have a whole lot of faith in.
No, I don't either. And you should have been on Chirinos yesterday. And it's one of those things where I just looked into the numbers a little bit more and I said, oh, the Jays, I mean, this is an opportunity maybe for Chirinos. He actually got pulled in that game without giving up a hit through five.
Like, yeah, it's crazy. Yeah, Chirinos. Yeah, it's time to start giving him and Urena a little credit, because they've been on a good run here.
Yeah, when you look into the numbers and you see the contact they give up and the hard contact that they allow, and you're just like, ah. But sometimes you just take an advantage of weaker lineups, and that was the case. So we'll be all over him, especially whenever he gets his next start. Who knows what the Rays, you know, what they do with their team and their starters, but this is a game that, yeah, it doesn't, I'm not appealed with anything that's going on in the Toronto side. I mean, if you play multiple lineups, you can still take the discount on Vlad Guerrero. He's cheap on both sites, but yeah, Choi has been one of the better values all year. Tommy Pham is had a good run here over the past couple weeks, but I would rather honestly spend up elsewhere on some bats like St. Louis.
All right, let's go to Miami, where they're hosting the San Francisco Giants. It's Trevor Richards and Jeff Samardzija in this one. Now, like, normally I look at this game and I go, okay, hard pass, whatever. But I think there's some things here to keep in mind, including one guy who's been red hot. We talk about baseball being a game of streaks. Harold Ramirez has been red hot. He's just 2.5 on FanDuel, another lineup builder, just 3.6 on DraftKings. I think Harold Ramirez is one of these bats to keep an eye on against Samardzija tonight. It's a good matchup, I think, for him. So that's just one name. Brian Anderson is another one of those guys that's kind of, you know, gets the job done. But really, the only guy I want to highlight in this game tonight is Harold Ramirez. I think he's a good one-off. Is there anybody else or anything else in this game worth highlighting for you, Chris?
No, I think that's fair to, you know, usually we'd be all in a matchup like this against Samardzija, you know, who has an 80% contact rate, a 50% fly ball rate, a 42% hard hit rate. Those are all numbers, you know, that you don't want. So they're red flags for sure. So normally we would, I think for me at least, I would maybe highlight a couple of Miami players and just trying to find that value, but there really isn't a lot of pitching to spend up for. But if you do want to spend up for some pitching, Ramirez, I think, is a good call. And so is Anderson. Those are like, Anderson is a good contact guy, doesn't strike out a ton. So, you know, I like him in that three spot as maybe like some standalone value, but you're not stacking anything. It's probably going to be a low scoring game, but I definitely won't roll out any of these pitchers.
Now, speaking of spending up for pitchers, you got David Price, who is 8.4 on FanDuel, 9.4 on DraftKings. So big difference there, $1,000 difference between the two of them. So you really got to have to take it for David Price, but very cheap for David Price, which I imagine at home tonight, it's kind of a weird pricing. It's almost begging for high ownership. Yeah. And I don't think it's wrong, because that Cleveland lineup is still completely unimpressive. So I'm okay with it. I think it's fine. I think it's chalky. I think it's safe. I think it's probably safer than Boyd, just because of the
right
offense. You know what I mean? Like the offense, the at home, all those things go in the favor of David Price. But I don't know. I mean, it's just, I think it's going to be one of those things where you look at, it's going to be 60% owned in cash games tonight.
It may even be more on FanDuel, Joe, because there's nine pitchers that are more expensive than David Price. I don't understand it. Like Lyles, Perez has been good, fine, but he's got to go
avoid up against Price if you want to stand out tonight. That's the guy.
It. Yeah. I think, again, if you're going to cash, that he is probably the number one option because of the price. But if you're going to tournaments, maybe you want to be a little bit different here.
Well, that's where Boyd comes in for me. A boy comes in because I think people will go, well, it's on the road, and, well, Detroit kind of sucks. But you know what? At the same time, Detroit's put up some numbers recently. They put up a bunch of runs in the Mets series last week, and they put up some runs on the weekend. I don't know. I just feel like Matt Boyd, you get up to play for Matt Boyd, and I think they'll do enough to get it done, whereas just Price, the ownership on the FanDuel side, is just going to be through the roof. Strasburg, too, another guy, too. He's 10.6 on FanDuel tonight going in to take on Max Fried, who's 8.9 on FanDuel. On DK, 11.8 for Strasburg. Max Fried stays at 8.1. With the Nationals offense, I feel like this is a trap tonight. I don't know. I want to be in on Strasburg. I mean, it's just tough. I guess the Nationals are just kind of spooking me out, Chris.
Yeah, I don't blame you. I really don't blame you. And Strasburg's been good. 87 strikeouts, 18 walks, two or fewer runs in seven of his past 10 starts. So, like, those are solid numbers. But, you know, as I mentioned off the top, I was just really looking into some of the success that Atlanta's had against Strasburg. I mean,
and against righties, too. 339 team Woba against right-handed pitching. So
don't strike out. Take their walks, make a lot of contact. And Braves have racked up 9 runs on 15 hits in their last 11 innings against Strasburg. That obviously dates back to last year, but I can't get there. I can't get there because of the price. Maybe I'll have one share, but even still, like, I'd have to play multiple tournament lineups to feel comfortable with him and to roll him out against the Braves. And even if he does pitch a gem, I just don't have any confidence that they'll be able to have some success the offense because –
He pitches a gem, he doesn't get a win. This kind of, you know, almost a repeat of yesterday with Scherzer. I think they're spinning their wheels, and I don't always like to hold the manager accountable, but it seems like that's what's going to happen sooner than later.
Yeah.
I don't think he makes it to the All-Star break. I really don't. I think he's going to be gone.
I agree. They need to move.
It seems to be the trend of where things are going. By the way, on the Line Star app, on the DraftKings side at least, the optimizer likes David Price, biggest return on investment, even at the 94. But you know who's number two? Matt Boyd.
Right
behind him. And they actually have Matt Boyd projected for one more point, almost a full point more projection-wise for Matthew Boyd tonight. So we're not crazy.
No.
It's, you know, and this is why I like to always go back. I always like to reference back and forth between Line Star and between what we say, because sometimes it's some of the feelings we have, they get verified in the numbers and vice versa. Sometimes there's traps out there that we feel and they're verified by the numbers. And that's always a good thing to go through there. And in return on investment, Strasburg is lower down on the optimizer. He is just flat out in the middle of the pack, and I don't blame him for being there. Like, I just feel like that's where it is. John Lester against Corbin Martin. Now, here's an interesting one, because Lester's been pretty good this year. Yeah. He is very cost effective as a secondary pitcher at 7.5 on DK. I got to imagine that that's going to have a lot of heat, especially against the team that's not 100%. I know Altuve's due back, I think, later in the week, but still, Houston's been up and down. Without Springer, without Altuve, I think John Lester, you could take a shot on tonight. What do you think?
If you know, really looking into Lester
as a secondary guy, not as like your one pitcher, but like you're looking for a number two, like a pairing with Price or a pairing with Boyd, I think Lester is a decent one.
Yeah, and this is what I mean about getting nuts in tournaments, like rolling out a guy like John Lester, who, if you look at his last two starts, he's given up 17 hits, 9 runs, 3 homers. So those two starts have been bad, but his first 7 starts, he only gave up 5 runs. That was a span of 38 innings. He didn't walk anybody. He was striking guys out. He wasn't giving up home runs. He was keeping the ball on the ground. So that's a solid sample size of really good pitching from John Lester. And you're right. There's no Springer in this lineup, no Altuve. At least I don't think Altuve is going to come back today. But if he's not, I mean, that's an opportunity where you roll out a guy like John Lester. On the flip side, Corbin Martin, we like prospects. We understand the strikeout upside is there, but for Corbin Martin, 80% contact rate, fly ball rate, hard hit rates, pushing 40%. He's given up 14 hits, 7 runs, 3 homers, 6 walks already in 12 innings. So it may be an opportunity for the Cubs to attack him and get some run support for Lester.
Spread too. Like, that's kind of,
Yeah, it's high, it's huge. So they're projecting some runs in this game, but I think Lester for tournaments as a secondary pitcher, you're right. I think, you know, you can roll him out there, and that allows you're not going to have high ownership with Lester. You'll be able to pivot off some of these top.
Yeah, expected total is 9.5, right? Am I seeing?
No, yeah, you're right. Yeah, expected total is 9.5. Yep.
Yeah, I think it's going to come on the Cubs side. I really do.
I do too. And you know what? Bryant traveled with the team. He's not ruled out of this game. I know he had a heavy collision over the weekend, but he did travel, so he could return, and that makes the Cubs lineup. That would probably bring the total up to 10.5. Just for,
yeah. But in the meantime, there are some discounts on some of those guys too. You know, when you're looking at it, if he's not in the lineup, then a guy like Schwarber maybe becomes more appealing.
I love Schwarber.
Albert Almora. Almora's been another guy too who's been hitting, and that's not usually his MO, more of a defensive maven, so to speak. Martin Perez hosting the Milwaukee Brewers tonight. I love the Minnesota side of this one. Perez is 9.1. Right. Is he confirmed? He is Martin Perez.
I was actually just
Smeltzer going back and forth.
Yeah. I was actually just typing in Perez to try to find some word on him. You know what? He may have gotten scratched.
Did he indeed get scratched? Okay. Look, as we're recording this here, still things will filter in. We'll check on that. We'll skip it. We'll come back to Lucas Giolito.
He won't start tonight. He's not going to start. He's scheduled to make his next start Thursday against the Rays. So I'm not hearing why he's not starting, but nonetheless, he's out of the lineup.
All right. Well, then you can fire up Ryan Braun and Yasmani Grandal and all those cheap guys who are around the $3,000 range on FanDuel tonight. And go for it.
Yeah, for sure. Absolutely. This is going to be a high scoring game. And it's amazing. We got 9 runs yesterday and we got 9 runs early, and it did not creep over that 9.5 total. Mini started off strong, but Zach Davies is not somebody that I believe in. I really don't. You know, there's a lot of buzz because his first 9 starts, he allowed 2 or fewer runs in all of them. But, you know, you look deeper into the numbers. This is a guy who's got a high strand rate, an xFIP that's around 5, an ERA that's mid 2s. Gives up a lot of contact, fly balls. So he got rocked in his last start. 6 earned runs, 2 homers. I'm not buying into him. You might see 6-5 and you see overall a decent strikeout or a decent ERA, but only 38 strikeouts in 55 innings. The Twins are going to have some success. This is going to be a high scoring game if you can fit these guys in. And that will, Joe, when you roll out a guy like Lester, or, you know, if you want to take the discount on price, again, chalky, get some bats in this because you can afford it.
Yeah, I get to. I'm right there with you, man. I think whenever you have that spot starter guy, you're going to get a lot of soft middle relief, and I love that when it comes to DFS. Lucas Giolito, 9.4 on FanDuel, 9.9 on DK tonight. Giolito has been terrific. Do you like really this whole matchup against the Royals for that price?
It's a little expensive for me. I really don't want to spend that much.
Well, what more does he have to do to prove it to you?
I know, right? He's been actually...
I kind of feel the same way you do, but I feel like he deserves it. I feel like
he does.
I feel like he's another one of these guys I put in the pivot to price if you want to.
Yeah.
The price ownership is just going to be through the roof.
Yeah, it really will. I mean, his last outing, he had a complete game shutout against the Astros where he struck out 9. I mean, he doesn't have to do anymore, actually, to prove it to me. Like, that alone is pretty solid. I mean, another outing earlier in the year against the Red Sox where he went 5, only gave it 3 runs, struck out 7. So, I mean, it is a good spot.
Look, over his last 5 starts, he's got 4 wins. He's got 36 strikeouts, 9 walks.
Amazing.
In 33 innings. I mean, that's what you want. I mean, 21 hits. I mean, He's certainly been on a good trend. I think he's another pivot tonight. I think him and Boyd are in that grouping. And I think there's what we're discussing, the sentiment, Chris, is kind of what's out there in Giolito. Yes. Everybody's excited about it, but are you ready to put your money there? I am tonight against Brad Keller. I think at home, I like Giolito in that potential spot there. So, you know, just keep an eye on things there. But I think so. Now, from an offensive standpoint, I don't love either of these lineups. I'm not loving that. So let's move on to Colorado, baby. So we got Merrill Kelly, Antonio Senzatella. Who are you firing up in this one? What side of the game do you like, or do you like the whole damn thing?
Yeah, you know, I like a lot of it. We mentioned Murphy. He's starting to heat up a little bit. Maybe, you know, just showing signs. You know, another hit yesterday, 3 multi-hit games in his past week. In fact, he's got hits in 7 of his last 8 games. Is that enough to get him into the lineup again tonight? Let's hope so, because we mentioned this yesterday when we looked on FanDuel. I mean, when you see Colorado guys that check in around 3K, it's puzzling. It sometimes steps you back a little bit. Like, Dahl is 3-7 and has some struggles. I think he went yard yesterday. Murphy, 3-6. Desmond has been in and out of the lineup, 3-4. But against Kelly, these are opportunities, I think, for these guys to, you know, return value. And so yeah, it's hard not to like Colorado and their 6.5 team implied total. Keep in mind the weather. It looks like maybe some potential rain and the wind's blowing in. There's some nastiness going on there, but I do like the bats in this lineup, especially from – and you know what? Sensatella has actually been brutal as well.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's what I mean. I think both sides – I just wish I felt better about that that offense in Arizona. I just don't love him right now. Marte I love, but he's super expensive. He's priced through the roof, so it's very difficult to get involved in this.
Maybe we can get Kevin Crone in that lineup. If Crone gets in that lineup, he'll be cheap.
Yeah, it'd be nice to see him play. That'd be nice. Hasn't. Yeah, come on. What the hell you call the guy up? I hate when they do. I hate when teams call up big prospect.
That's the point, yeah.
Why are you stealing at-bats from them when they could be getting their ABs, getting their work in? It's just crazy. All right, Frankie Montas is a guy that we've loved on this show. He's at an all-time high. On DraftKings tonight, he's 11.3. I think that's completely out of control. I like Montas. I understand it. I understand it's the Angels. I get it. He's 9.2 on FanDuel. I think that's kind of high considering some of the other pieces we talked about. Considering Giolito and Boyd, I think that I would rather have those guys than Montas. But 11.3, Chris, I'm out. Sorry. Done.
Yeah, I'm not saying to stack Angels here, but we always pick on them against lefties. I mean, they have the second-best average in baseball against right-handed bats right there behind the Astros. They're top 10 in terms of
– Ohtani on freaking DraftKings of all places, just 3.3. How'd that happen?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know.
He's 3.2 on FanDuel. He's 3.3. I mean, Ohtani's got to be in some lineups tonight. You got to have some Ohtani shares tonight.
Yeah, I mean, you definitely take that shot. Obviously, he's much better against, you know, right-handed pitching than he is left-handed pitching. So, yeah, even checking here, he checks in as a decent value. A lot of the LineStar, there's a lot of, you know, Tommy La Stella checks in as a value as well. So, I think Montas is the trap. As much as we've given him some love, keeps the ball on the ground. Obviously, pitching in Oakland is a huge plus. He's getting some run support from his squad lately. He's a bit of a trap for me. I'm not completely buying it. I'm not going to spend that kind of cash for him over on DK, and I don't feel great about him being my number one pitcher, my only pitcher on FanDuel. If you're in the late slate, sure, but I'd rather another guy.
I'll tell you what, if you're playing the late slate, forget the Texas Rangers too, because after Tommy Malone, you got Marco Gonzalez, another lefty. I don't care how bad the lefty is, it doesn't seem to matter.
No, it doesn't.
So I'm over it, which means I'm going, if I'm playing late slate only, I'm going Rich Hill cash games, and I'm just taking it easy. Because yeah. I don't buy into Steven Matz. He's, you know, I never will. That Dodger lineup is tremendous. I would just stack Dodgers. I know he's expensive on DK. He's 10.8 Rich Hill. But on FanDuel, he's just 8.8. And you can get Justin Turner 3.2. You can get Corey Seager 3.1. You can get Kiki at 2.7. You could probably even squeeze in Bellinger if you do it right with some of the other pieces and some of the other evening games. But Rich Hill's going to be heavily owned, I'm sure. And even on the main slate, how do you feel about Rich Hill stacking up? I know there's always...
I like him.
I like him too.
Yeah.
I wish he wasn't quite as expensive on DK, but I like him more on the FanDuel side at 8.8. I think is a real good matchup for him against the Mets.
Same. I really do. And in that tier, that's what I mean. Like Strasburg and Montas, I'm just not going to spend up. I'm going to save myself $1,000 from pivoting off Strasburg and $500 for pivoting off Montas. And you're right about the Dodgers. I mean, they've had a ton of success against left-handed pitching this year. I mean, Bellinger, obviously, 338, six homers, but Hernandez has four bombs. Muncy has four bombs. Hernandez hitting 300 against lefties. And we're starting to see Corey Seager, rather. I know he's a lefty, and it doesn't seem to make sense, but he is also another guy that is starting to trend up a little bit. And when you look at these pricing, of course, you don't have to roll through them on FanDuel. The entire lineup is value on FanDuel.
Yeah.
But on DraftKings... Seager.
It's an easy Dodger stack in a late game and late game only slate.
It is. Yeah. Roll them out there.
And, you know, if you're looking to play cash tonight, that's the way to do it. And I'm glad we're starting to talk more about that too, the more isolating. And I know sometimes you're like, but I want to play all these games. Well, sometimes it's not the best way to win money. Sometimes you take a look at a slate and you go, you know what I'm better off doing? Put my cash game money if I want to play into the late slate and do it that way. Take some of the diversity out of it a little bit and some things that can hurt you. Okay, so we've hit that point in the program, Chris, where we're going to call our shot. It's your turn. You go first tonight. Where are you going, Yard?
I might as well head to Minnesota because I just ripped Davies. I got to try to back it up. So I am going to go with Eddie Rosario.
Eddie Rosario, an old staple of yours. You're going back to the last guy staple. You got, right? Yeah. It's fair. It's fair enough. I'm going to go to that Philadelphia game. And I'm going to go with Paul Goldschmidt. How you like that, baby?
Oh, I do like that.
I like Goldie on Nick Pivetta. You know, you throw 95, that's fine. You throw it right down the middle, Paul Goldschmidt's going to hit it far away. So Goldie and Rosario tonight. So who you got betting-wise, Chris? What are you looking at for the lines?
I'm looking at the Dodgers at home. I definitely like that feeling a lot. I think there's going to be some runs scored in Colorado and Arizona. I think you can take the over 12 there. I think you can take the over in Milwaukee and Minnesota at 9.5. If you're just looking for teams straight up, I like St. Louis on the road. They're actually road dogs tonight. I know it's Adam Wainwright, but I still like St. Louis. I like Boston at home. And I like the Braves. Even though they're going up against Strasburg, I like the Braves. I'm not feeling Washington at all.
All right, so there you have it. You can follow us on Twitter at JoePizzaPia17, at Chris Meany, and at LineStar App. That'll do it for me and Chris. The only thing left to do is step out of the on-deck circle and into the batter's box and go yard. We'll see you next time, kids.
You've been listening to the DFS On Deck podcast, brought to you by LineStar. Hit subscribe, tell a friend, and stay tuned for the next episode from fantasy baseball experts Joe Pizzapia and Chris Meany.